My name is Will Glover. I'm the director of the Center for South Asian Studies. I teach in the history department. I've been looking forward to this evening for months, literally, and I'm very excited. And what an amazing evening we have in store for us. This is the inaugural lecture of the Kavita Saraswati Datla Memorial Lecture Series, an annual lecture endowed with loving generosity by Kavita's family and friends. Kavita passed away a little over a year ago now, and she's sorely missed by her loved ones, by her students and colleagues, and by her friends near and far. But this annual lecture provides us all something very precious. It means that one day every year, we don't have to miss Kavita quite so much. We don't have to miss her because she's here with us in our hearts and in the intellectual, lively intellectual conversations that are about to take place. We have Professor Sudipta Kaviraj here to deliver the inaugural lecture, a scholar of formidable brilliance, and we'll hear more about that in a moment. I want to welcome Dr. and Mrs. Raju, Kavita's parents, to Ann Arbor tonight. We're grateful that you're here with us on this inaugural evening. I want to welcome Vishnu and Bobby, Kavita's brothers. Both of you are U of M alums as well, I believe. And Vishnu told me every apartment that he used to live in has now been demolished, and there's a new plaza there. He did a little drive around this afternoon. And I want to welcome the friends of the Datla family who drove through some pretty inclement weather to get here and to be with us this afternoon. I met Kavita when she came to Berkeley to start her PhD in 1997. I was given orders in no uncertain terms by my close friends Farina Mir and Munis Faruqi that I was to pick Kavita up at the San Francisco airport and find her a clean, safe, affordable apartment in Berkeley right away. Kavita and I spent the day driving around looking at dodgy, overpriced apartments together, and eventually she settled for the least bad one. But we formed a fast friendship that afternoon, and that's something I'll always cherish. Farina and Munis came to know Kavita, in turn, while she was pursuing her master's degree at JNU in Delhi. There, Kavita lived in another apartment of similar description in a place called Katvariya Sarai in South Delhi with two other very important characters in tonight's story. They were sisters, Rama and Karuna Mantana. Actually, all three of them were sisters in the spiritual sense and the best of friends as well since childhood. Rama was the ringleader, well-known fact. She was the oldest sister, the one who broke down the barriers for Karuna and Kavita, both. Rama stayed out late first. Rama broached the issue of dating first. And Rama was the first to pursue a PhD and become a tenured professor, which both of her kid sisters also eventually did, Kavita and Karuna. Watch out for kid sisters, though. That's my message to you tonight. Karuna Mantana, Professor Karuna Mantana, was the shy, quiet one. She's still that way, but now she's a Harvard-educated, tenured professor at Yale in the political science department. Her first book, Alibis of Empire, Henry Maine and the Ends of Liberal Imperialism, is actually a tour de force of political theory and history, one that boldly analyzes the transformation of 19th century British imperial ideology. Her current project is on the political thought of Mahatma Gandhi, and on political realism and the politics of nonviolence more generally. I asked Karuna here today to introduce our distinguished speaker, Sudipta Kaviraj. In part, it's because they share several intellectual projects in common. But I also asked her here because of her very special friendship with Kavita. This is why I wrote this down and printed it out. Karuna was there for Kavita through her struggle with a terrible illness in the most extraordinarily attentive and loving of ways. Quiet little kid sister, turns out, was not only brilliant, but endowed with the most noble and powerful gift of friendship I think I've ever seen. She's the right person to get the evening going for us tonight. So please help me welcome Professor Connor Namontano to the stage to introduce tonight's speakers.
Thank you for that. thank you all for being here. I want to especially thank again Will and Farina for not only this lovely introduction, but also for really their extraordinary work in making this memorial lecture come together so soon and in a place that I think really is Kavita's spiritual home. As many of you know, Kavita was born in Hyderabad, but grew up mostly in various places in Michigan. Ann Arbor is the sort of center from Battle Creek to Kalamazoo, and especially West Bloomfield, where I knew her and some of her friends from high school are here as well. But she also spent many summers of her childhood and adult life in Hyderabad, and that was her lifelong intellectual interest, unearthing Hyderabad's layered contested history. She and that love of Hyderabad came first at her undergraduate days here at the University of Michigan, where she majored in history. She took classes with Nicholas Dirks, Tom Troutman, who's here today, and Amir Mufti, and became intrigued by the story of Ras Masood, Syed Ahmed Khan's grandson, who was sent by the Hyderabad state to Japan to investigate its educational system. That led her on her long-term interest in thinking about Muslim educational projects and their cosmopolitan inspirations and aspirations. During her time here, her senior thesis was also another chapter of Hyderabad's history. It was on gender and the women in the Telangana people's struggle and its historiography. So very early on and shaped in this very space were these different and layered aspects of Hyderabad's contested history that she continued to traverse and bridge her whole life. As Will just mentioned, she took this unusual decision to pursue a master's in history at JNU, at Jawaharlal Nehru University in Delhi, and under the supervision of Niladri Bhattacharya and especially Majid Siddiqui, she wrote her thesis on the education of the Nizam under imperial rule. This is what Majid has to say about her. Kavita's, quote, utter originality of work and personality. She was rebellious and could think outside the, quote, theoretically beleaguered context of Indian historiography. The language of secular Islam, quote, overturned the idea that Muslims and Urdu in modern Indian history were synonymous and that the Congress movement secularism was the only seriously political potent drive towards an independent India that would be equitous and multicultural. But what was truly audacious was that Kavita made this revisionary argument from Hyderabad. Quote, nobody in their wildest dreams, including me, this is Majid, would have accepted the Nizam's and Osmania University's location as the historical provenance of such an idea. At JNU, after JNU, she came to Berkeley, again, as Will narrated, to complete her PhD in 2006. At Berkeley, she worked closely with Professors Tom and Barbara Metcalf, who also have an association here with Ann Arbor. Kavita was almost the perfect melding of their interests, of Barbara's work on the history of Islam in South Asia and Tom's in imperial politics. In the monograph that developed from her dissertation, The Language of Secular Islam, Urdu Nationalism in Colonial India, she studied the founding of India's first vernacular university, Osmania University, and its translation projects to modernize Urdu. Kavita showed how Muslim intellectuals worked not merely to promote Urdu as a language of and for Muslims, but to forge a national vernacular fit for modern purposes. She was keen to recast the political disagreements around the status of Urdu as a clash of competing secular agendas within the context of Indian nationalism. To show these, and she also wanted to show these, how these alternative political and social imaginaries, in this case a cosmopolitan and secular vision of Urdu, eventually were minoritized and thwarted by the fraught politics of the transition from empire to nation state. Her last years were focused on an ambitious new project, Sovereign Claims, Hyderabad and the British Imperial Order. It's structured around three key moments in Hyderabad's history: the origins of British imperial expansion, the restoration of empire in the wake of 1857, and the emergence of independent India in 1947. She chose these moments to probe and complicate the history of the consolidation of empire and nation in South Asia. Indirect rule in Hyderabad becomes an exemplary site from which to interrogate the working and making of sovereignty. It was as ambitious as, and like her earlier work, really focused on revising some fundamental perspectives in the historiography of South Asia and using material from an unexpected source, Hyderabad. Again, like in the first book, if Urdu from the Deccan, not of northern India, was the carrier of cosmopolitan imagination, in the second project, she uses the system of indirect rule in Hyderabad, with Hyderabad at its core, rather than the conquest of Bengal, as laying the imprint of a form of sovereignty that sustained modern empire and laid the foundations of the international order. This second work sustained and invigorated Kavita in her last year. She worked doggedly. It was nothing short of astonishing during her illness to finish this book. And we are, with the help of people in this room, we're editing and hoping it'll be published very soon. Kavita was very invested and concerned with the vocation of the historian and lived the life of intellectual scholarship and engagement with unwavering integrity, intellectual, ethical, and political, and some of that again was framed here. I do remember the first time I really believe her love of archives was as high school students. We trudged over here in a similar days like this in winter days to use the document center at the library for our Model United Nations preparations. And I'm thrilled that Professor Kaviraj will be the inaugural lecturer. One of the things I wanted to mention was to introduce Kaviraj is to say some of their overlapping interests. In one of the last interviews Kavita gave, she talked about what she thought was an exciting moment for South Asian history and what the historiography of South Asia can provide. And so much of it is shaped also by her engagement with questions and themes that have been framed by Sudipta Kaviraj and his enormous impact in the field of thinking about modern South Asia. This is Kavita. South Asianists are at their best when they address big questions about the experience of capitalism, colonialism, and democracy, and how they have created the political and economic predicaments which plague us in the present, all of which, of course, requires us to think across regions. Within South Asia, we can and should talk about the diverse ways in which these experiences have been addressed. In other words, I think we could stand in having more robust and intimate political genealogies. We especially need scholars of the pre-modern period attuned to modern theory who can show us things did not have to end up the way that they did, to introduce us to radically different ways of doing and seeing things. And in this respect, it's a very exciting time to think across periods in South Asia. Sudipta Kaviraj is the professor of Indian politics and intellectual history at the Department of Middle East, South Asian, and African Studies at Columbia University. He is the foremost scholar for at least a generation and also building students across two generations of really thinking through intellectual history in Indian politics. He's worked across really building the field of Indian social and political thought, especially in the 19th and 20th centuries, but also more generally thinking theoretically and historically about the nature of Indian modernity and the nature of India's political modernity. He received his PhD from JNU in New Delhi and also taught there for many years. He then moved on to the Department of Political Studies at the School of Oriental and African Studies at the University of London. And most recently, he's been teaching at Columbia. He's also one of the original members of the Subaltern Studies Collective. I would say for most of us, the seminal work that we were probably introduced to Professor Kaviraj's work was the 1995 book, The Unhappy Consciousness, Bankim Chandra Chattopadhyay and the Formation of Nationalist Discourse in India. But along the last 10 years and over the course of many years, Professor Kaviraj has written enormously influential and important essays from the imaginary institution of India, Marxism and the darkness of history, to more recently, what we always remember as a revisionary history of modernity, and many others. And we've been lucky that over the last 10 years, this enormous range of interest and scholarship has come out in four very important collections of essays: the Imaginary Institution of India, Imaginary Institution of India, the Trajectories of the Indian State, the Enchantment of Democracy in India, as well as the Invention of Private Life. Today, Professor Kaviraj will speak on a very, bringing together two, I think, really important themes and questions that he's pursued. One, again, addressing a major intellectual figure of modern India, B.R. Ambedkar, and thinking through a major theme is the way we theorize and think through the question of history, and this will be the topic together. So I invite you to invite and welcome Professor Kaviraj.
I'm very grateful to the organizers, Professor Farina Mir and Professor Will Glover, and the Center for South Asian Studies, University of Michigan, for the invitation to give the first lecture in Kavita's name. And I want to thank her family for creating this occasion, for remembering her and celebrating her life. I knew her well. I later discovered that she had spent some time at JNU, where I had taught for 20 years, so this was an added connection. My first act is to express my sadness and to mourn, as part of the community of South Asian scholars, the loss of one of our most promising young historians. The Mahabharata says at one place, I'll quote the Sanskrit thing, Divang sprishati bhumincha shabdang punyena karmana yavat sa shabdo bhavate tavat purusha uchyate. As long as the word of the good acts of a person touches this earth and the sky, in some sense that person's existence still continues, as it does with us today. Memory is our only reply to such loss. What I shall talk about this evening is a bit unusual for my subject, political theory. In reading political theory, we enter into a world primarily of argumentation, of clear statements, clarifications, counter-arguments, conclusions. Today's subject is more like the treatment of literary themes. It's partly a matter of aesthetic judgment, where judgments are matters of taste rather than of clear demonstration. Yet, it is also about a major political theorist for modern India, and it's about a major concern that he carried throughout his life. A question that had a peculiar eruptive presence in his writings, because it's a question that he cannot resolve and yet cannot abandon. Looking at the paintings of an artist like, say, Caravaggio, we cannot avoid an overwhelming, looming sense of the darkness of his palette. A metaphysical darkness at the core of his world seems always trying to burst into the canvas. We often have that sense in reading the work of poets, that human existence is tinged by an indelible layer of melancholy, a predominant rasa that permeates not a single work, but the totality of his production. Reading Ambedkar and some Dalit writers who do not write poetry or creative literature, I feel the presence of a similar ineradicable tone of grief, a tone in both senses of the word, like an oral tone of music and a tone of color in painting. But because of some reasons strongly related to the internal features of political theory as a genre of writing and thinking, there's a strange obstruction, in my view, in the path of expression of this affect in Ambedkar. My paper seeks to understand the nature of this obstruction and its transcendence in Ambedkar's long reflection, always interrupted and always resumed, on the elusive history of untouchability. We cannot read political theory entirely divested of the techniques of literary reading. Though we always feel this is less important, all works of political theory are written, in Frege's sense, in a particular tone. By a preliminary distinction between sense and tone, Frege separated all questions not related to sense and quarantined them into a residual concept so that they did not intrude into his subsequent analysis of how language carried sense. This distinction immediately opens up an interesting prospect for reading of political theory. Clearly, in addition to the readings we subject them to, political theory could be subjected to a reading in terms of tone as well. When we read Hobbes and Locke, we encounter a clear tone distinction. From Hobbes's radical tone of defiance against the dominant Christian ideas of his time about the nature of man, the presence of God, the impact of religion in human life, to Locke's utterly different tone of acceptance of the deep reasonableness of Christian starting points, like the world as a gift of God to all men in common, only to be entirely transcended by the powerful enunciation of a theory of unlimited accumulation of property in the next few pages of that chapter. Tone is a perfectly possible subject of analysis in reading political theory, and if we decide to supplement reading of theoretical sense with the reading of linguistic tone, we can supplement our conventional reading by techniques of literary theory. But in case of Ambedkar and the kind of critical theory he represents, an analysis of tone leads to more fundamental theoretical insights. Among modern thinkers, Ambedkar was undoubtedly the most skillful user of the liberal language of political thinking. What I mean by language here should be explicated clearly. Language is not something that we voluntarily use and optionally when we are taking steps in a particular process of actual reasoning. Language, in this sense, refers to something more underlying and profound, something that both enables and limits our thought. It's a fundamental way of conceiving what the political world of states, societies, domination, subordination is really like, and what can be done to it, and in what ways. In that sense, the disparate and distinct languages of the political world not merely suggest diverse and contending solutions to particular shared problems. Rather, they start by conceptually building up the world itself in distinctive ways and go on to their particular pattern of setting up problems and seeking solutions. To characterize an author like Ambedkar strictly, we have to discern the defining features of his language. Ambedkar's language is firstly entirely modern. He has a total irreverence towards the antiquity of his society, except for Buddhism. He believed there was little valuable, serviceable, or morally defensible in the heritage of Hindu thought. Inside the universe of modern politics, Ambedkar is clearly in favor of the language of liberalism. That is the language of his unmistakable choice. That is the heritage that he draws upon and exalts in his polemics against nationalist doctrines that gave priority to political over social freedom. That is the language that he wields to denounce the practice of caste society in Hinduism, the language he uses masterfully in the detailed and constantly shifting context of constitutional politics, and the language he deploys with precision and foresight in the great opportunity he gets in shaping the Indian constitution. Ambedkar was formed through a typically Macaulayan education. The syllabi he mastered and excelled in consisted of the great Western canon of social and political theory. His writing showed two types of affiliation to liberal thought. Like many of his contemporaries, he was clearly attracted by the high rationalistic tradition of the Enlightenment, emphasizing particularly two strands of thinking: the uncompromising rationalistic critique of religion and the high liberal fervor for the expansion of liberty. For Ambedkar, in the low-caste Indian context, this doctrine of liberty must have meant the first fundamental principle of liberation, to pursue a life of one's own choice, not the religiously sanctioned and mythically ennobled incarceration of life into a defiling, dehumanized toil. Strangely, in the Indian context, he saw the abstract principle of liberty refined and split into two separate lines of reasoning, when he was young, leading to two entirely different agendas for political action. From early on, Ambedkar instinctively set up a distinction between the two readings of liberal freedom: the Gandhian emphasis on the freedom of the nation from British rule, and social freedom focused on the freedom of the lower castes from subordination in the Hindu social order. He instinctively sided with leaders like Ranade, whose politics of equality implied that a society that was not internally equal did not deserve to demand freedom from colonial government. Self-rule of the nation should be based not merely on the abstract moral self-rule of the self-restraining individual, like Gandhi, but self-rule of the lower castes from the abusing customs of caste. Negative liberty comes before the luxury of thinking what positive liberty would mean. Ambedkar's affiliation to the liberal language of political thought comes very early and is entirely decisive and irreversible. Never did he rethink or revise this profound affiliation. It's interesting that though he had access to an equally modernist and apparently more radical language of social change in Marxian socialism, he never relied on that except for scaring the property classes in the Congress leadership periodically with the specter of a communist revolution. I think the reason for that rejection is simple. Ambedkar saw Indian Marxism as a form of thought entirely trapped in a Eurocentric obsession with economically defined class, unable to recognize the obvious and profound form of inequality in their own society. Eventually, Ambedkar became a real master of the theoretical language of liberalism, absorbing training in its intricacies and elaboration in two of its primary intellectual centers in the US and England, though the London School of Economics was an early hub of socialist reflection as well. Dewey's influence seems to have been profound and methodologically critical on Ambedkar, because Dewey was an innovative extender of liberal doctrine to new questions and fields of inquiry like education. This seems to have shown Ambedkar that the meaning of being a good liberal was not an obstinate repetition of its catechisms, but elaboration of his central moral principles towards new analytical domains. He did more than anyone else to construct a radical form of liberal politics in the very different context of Indian political life. On one question, however, the two languages of liberal and socialist thinking were very similar. Both languages of modern political thought emerge from a shared secular tradition, but secularity works here in a peculiar fundamental sense. In the great early modern thinkers like Hobbes, the universe of politics is increasingly conceived as mundane in an intensified sense. Generally, these thinkers did not question the existence of God or his perceptible presence in the world, but it seems clear to them that that divine presence is not to be regarded as a reliable protection from the possible predations of the modern state. In a sense, the whole business of political theory and of constitutionalism, which was at the center of Ambedkar's thinking always, emerged from this gap, absence of flaw, in the world's mundane arrangements. To secure political justice and to find protection against a state turned hostile, the presence of a hidden god was not a reliable remedy. Anti-modern thinkers often detected a connection between the strengthening materialism of modern social theory and a worldly orientation. Weber, for instance, faulted the Indian caste system for fostering otherworldliness, which allowed false rationalizations of social fate, like the curse of being born in a low caste. Ambedkar noted sharply the malignant effects of a theory of karma on the acceptance of a degrading fate. By making birth into a low caste not an accident, not even a curse, but a precisely accurately measured recompense for the accounting of a human being's acts, karma, in a previous birth, Ambedkar clearly saw the perverse intelligence of this theory made the victim responsible for his own misfortune. Logically, it left no recourse to persons except acting well within the sectoral dharma of his birth caste and with an unshakable belief in the justness of the cosmic order, hope to be born better in the soul's next passage on this earth. This segmentary conception of dharma was at the center of his outrage at the travesty of morality in Hinduism. As a modernist, Ambedkar assumes that rules of morality must be marked by a form of Kantian universalism. A tenet that is good for one person must be good for all. Otherwise, it did not qualify as a moral rule. Drawing on this line of thought, he could argue that the detailed instructions about differential punishments in the Manusmriti were the travesty of the very idea of justice, of the very conception of what a moral rule was. The Manusmriti in particular was outrageous, not because its rules were degrading and discreetly indefensible, but because it was premised on a monstrous lie about the nature of morality itself. He could have gone forward and claimed, alongside his startling claim that Hinduism did not constitute a society, a point that he made often, that Hindu texts of this kind also did not have a conception of morality. But my concern is not with this line of thought, because Ambedkar is clear and eloquent about these faults of Hindu metaphysics. It's often noted that philosophical materialism leads to a kind of experiential presentism. Since what is happening to us in the present moment, which can be defined differently, of course, that the present can be elongated or shortened, has an immediate effect on us in all senses, materially and intellectually, it gets a natural preponderance in our cognitive attention. The past and the future might be abstractly equally significant parts of time, but in this sense, they're less materially pressing than the time of the present. If we can designate this kind of uneven emphasis on different segments of time, past, present, and future, we could say that we can detect an underlying latent structure of temporality in every kind of political theory. I'm using temporality in a special, rather narrow meaning. Temporality in my use is not just a fancier name for time itself, but the way time, which is necessarily abstract and infinite, is given a structure, something akin to a shape, by stressing some of its parts at the expense of others. It will be seen that modern political theory, in both its modern forms of liberalism and Marxism, are futuristic, in the sense that because the present is still happening and the future is still to happen, the political activity of seeking justice and social reconstruction must be oriented toward these segments of time. At times, this bias in favor of present experience and materiality, the prejudice simply in favor of simple existence itself, is seen to have troubling consequences in liberal judicial rules. I'll give an example from England. Two young boys were bludgeoned a toddler to death. In their trial and afterwards, the entire orientation of the judicial process seems to be to ensure that the perpetrators are treated with the care owed to young children, hastening their rehabilitation as moral persons so that they can enjoy a successful human life. The mother of the toddler agitated against this entire procedure because she thought that justice for her child, who was also a moral person, was sacrificed. But the argument goes down a brutal rock bottom where the basic point of persuasion is that the lives of the two perpetrators are still existent in the present and possible in future. The life of the toddler, unfortunately, is impossible to continue and therefore can be there can be a reasonable suspension of moral considerations of care towards him, as he is now incapable of being cared for. An argument that is at bottom very similar would be advanced by both liberal and socialist theory regarding questions like instances of atrocities in the irrevocable past. Both theories would, according to their lights and to their respective principles, demand a politics of justice for social groups who are wronged. Liberal theory would recommend social initiatives and state action to counteract practice of social injustice like caste, socialists to counteract poverty. But both types of social theories are secular and materialistic in this common sense, that they would strain every nerve to eradicate such practices. Think of color, think of slavery in the modern West and the continuing degradation and denial of equal legal rights to people of color and women. Liberal and socialist theory carried on real moral crusades against these social wrongs, eventually to some victory. Yet these theories are indifferent towards the past. At most, they might regard the evidence of the past subjection of groups to inegalitarian atrocity as a deplorable aspect of the society's history. But eventually, they have a deep, active orientation towards society. Their central question, after the necessary work of moral judgment is concluded, is what can be done? What can we do to right these wrongs? The trouble with history is the irreversible inaccessibility of the past to present action. And the fact that because of that pastness, somehow the crucial phase, what can we do about it, becomes inoperative and ineffectual. Action is rendered impossible simply by obstructing the tenets of the case. Action is barred, deflected, the demand for action rebounds in some sense from the temporal surface of the historical past. The eventual attitude of futuristic, future-oriented, and action-oriented theories is to accept silence. This was true of social theory in Ambedkar's time, though in recent times, new speculation has begun on some of these questions. A reading of Ambedkar immediately reveals two things: Ambedkar's fluent and mastery in the language of liberalism, and his deep melancholy at the idea which that language seems to force upon us, that we should necessarily accept this silence. Consider three of his texts, which circle back explicitly to this question of origin and the injustice of this silence about past injustice. I have mentioned three texts. I would not give you the analysis of all three. I'll stick to the first because I'm still working on the other texts now. The first is probably the most academic piece, Castes in India, the Mechanism, Genesis, and Development, presented for the Ethnology Seminar at Columbia with A.A. Goldenweiser in 1916, later published in Indian Antiquity in 1917. 20 years later, he wrote The Annihilation of Caste, a lecture to be delivered at the Jatpath Todak Mandal, a reform organization, which puzzlingly demanded editing and dropping some passages they found unacceptably radical, making Ambedkar withdraw from the event. But precisely for his uncompromisingness, that essay remains a major statement of his thinking. In 1946, Ambedkar published Who Were the Shudras, which was linked to the extension of his historical inquiry to the further question, the origins of untouchability, published after independence in 1948. In the introduction to this essay, Caste in India, Its Mechanism, Genesis, and Development, there's a subtle insertion of a move that makes a departure from the accepted methods of discipline he was studying at Columbia. I quote, "A student of ethnology is much like a guide to a historical site like Pompeii," Ambedkar writes. "He holds up the social institutions to view with all the objectiveness humanly possible and inquires into their origins and function," end of quote. The sentence seems unremarkable, yet it contains a surplus or a supplementary question that was entirely outside the normal science methods of anthropology of its time. To understand how a social institution works, of course, scholars must grasp how its constituent elements actually function, I'm emphasizing function, and explore, if possible, how it, that is, its way of functioning, came into existence. So the first thing is to understand how it functions, which is the ethnographic question, and the second is to understand how that functioning came into existence, which is the historical question. We must remind ourselves that when he was writing the paper, Ambedkar had been studying anthropology in Columbia, one of the premier institutions in this new field, for 3 years, presumably absorbing the methodology that demarcates this field off from two neighboring disciplines, which also study human societies and their institutions: the conventional discipline of history and the more recent one of sociology. At their origin, disciplines tend to be particularly sensitive and insistent about their method because these precisely separate them off from others. Why did academic knowledge need a discipline called ethnography or anthropology when it already had these two? The answer had to be methodological. Ambedkar himself notes, without expressing any discomfort, that the seminar was concerned with the fundamental distinction between primitive and modern societies. And it was now his turn to entertain, within quotes, his co-participants in the seminar with a paper which showed the mechanism, genesis, and development of castes in India. Yet the primitiveness of societies which ethnology dealt with was of a special kind, precisely the kind of society which were incontrovertibly primitive, that is, which had continued for long spans of time, yet which did not have a reliable record of this time spent. Societies that were recordless, without history, within quotes, and consequently in these societies, the primitiveness had to be read off from a kind of timeless, that is, time-suppressing structure in the present. Primitive is a technical term of methodological art. Primitive is not equivalent to ancient. Use of the term ancient implies that it's a state that is left behind, followed by something else, which acts as a foil to give the term ancient its precise semantic content. History deals with ancient societies. Ethnology has to solve the puzzle of primitiveness. Anthropologists did not produce history. They produced an alternate for historical knowledge by showing how these societies had a structure, how exactly its parts were linked to each other, and how these were functionally connected, a method which would be called later structural functionalism. This was, of course, the privileged method for studying the working of societies, which were presumably primitive, but whose lack of history deflected the historical question. They lived in an unhistorical time, lapse of time without evidence of change. The self-knowledge of these societies had a surface or a character from which historical questions, when, how, why, bounced off. Techniques of history did not have material they could grasp. Therefore, these had to be subjected to the methodologies of the freshly minted discipline. For a student who had studied under the disciple of Franz Boas in one of the first departments of anthropology, this move, therefore, was not part of normal science. The paper's actual analysis first addresses the question of mechanism, how the institution functions in the strong and peculiar sense that the discipline of anthropology was conferring on this verb. After critically assessing several authors who sought to define caste by some special defining characteristic, Ambedkar follows the work of Dr. Ketkar, who is, I quote, both a native and has an open mind, end of quote, to make two arguments. The first, which is remarkable at this very early stage of anthropology, is its conviction that trying to define caste by some special feature or a single principle is mistaken and inadequate. Caste is a structural fact, what we today call a structural fact. What creates caste, to deploy much later terminology, is the dominance of a structure. He also makes a second argument, which partly chimes with the insight of the structural character of the caste order. Caste depends on endogamy, he argues. Endogamy is the only characteristic that is peculiar to caste. But this is followed by an odd methodological claim, and I quote, "If we succeed in showing how endogamy is maintained, we shall practically have proved the genesis and also the mechanism of caste." So I put genesis and mechanism both in italics. End of quote. Ambedkar recognizes, I quote again, "There are a great many pitfalls in the path of those who try to unfold the past, and caste in India is, to be sure, a very ancient institution." Notice that he is not using primitive, it's an ancient institution. This is especially true where there exists no authentic or written record, or where the people, like the Hindus, are so constituted that to them writing history is folly, for the world is an illusion, end of quote. But the methodological technique to use in case of such obdurately ahistorical culture is to import the scientific techniques of paleontology. As often as not, customs and morals are like fossils that tend to tell their own story. He notes that the question of origin is always an annoying question, and in case of caste, this question has been sadly neglected. Later, Ambedkar clear-sightedly acknowledges the limits of a historical explanation. He wants to elucidate the mystery of the growth and development of caste. "Unfortunately," I quote, "a direct answer to this question is not within my power. I can only answer it indirectly," end of quote. The indirect answer he gives to this question again comes in two parts. Discounting the great man theory of history, which would attribute an act of Solonian inscription to the edicts of Manu, he concludes, I quote, "the spread and growth of the caste system is too gigantic a task to be achieved by the power or cunning of an individual or a class," end of quote. Rather, the task of anthropology is to show the falsity of the attitude that has exalted religious sanction to the position of scientific explanation. Simply describing the Shastric injunctions of the Manusmriti does not constitute an explanation of the caste system, simply a demonstration of the availability of recondite justifications for a long time. Brahmins, in order to ensure purity of blood, Ambedkar thinks, at some point institute endogamy within themselves, sealing the boundary between themselves and the rest of society. Subsequently, following the Tardian principle of hierarchy from Gabriel Tard, that is the emulation of the customs of superior groups by their inferiors in a social scale, other castes imitatively adopt endogamy, generating the familiar system of a completely impermeable system of social differences. Interestingly, despite its intellectual sophistication, the paper used the methodological techniques of early stage structuralist anthropology, which can and does address only the question of mechanism. Ambedkar's search for history fails. The question of genesis is turned from an historical question of origins into a structural elaboration of function. And the question of how caste originated remains unanswered in this early stage of academic writing. The question of history did not fade away from Ambedkar's concern, and we find him returning obsessively to the theme of origins. Twice at least he returns to this, but there is always a lack of conclusiveness. Each time there's a new attempt, seeking a new hypothesis as a starting point, not this steady accumulation of archival or archaeological facts so familiar in the standard historical inquiry. 20 years after his student essay, Ambedkar tried another version of the historical explanation in his undelivered lecture, Annihilation of Caste, and as I said, twice in 1946 and 1948, he wrote important essays returning to history, but trying different starting points. When we go through Ambedkar's repetitive forays into the past, we detect a kind of iterative structure. For any historical event or institution, which is a fact of a different kind, the question of origin, when and how did it come about, is an entirely legitimate one. The discipline of history has the specialized task of answering questions of this kind reliably with the evidence from its archive. Of course, there is no guarantee that all historical questions can be satisfactorily answered according to standards of epistemic validation. When intellectuals begin to think about the past, there are many significant occasions when, though the question is paramount for some historical need, the answer does not appear to be possible. It's important to emphasize that this problem appears not only in the case of Dalit history or in cases where subalternity is involved. In the works of Bankimchandra Chatterjee in 19th century Bengal, whom I studied, there's a similar insistent iterative concern about the past of his people, where the question is legitimate, even essential, but the path to an answer seems to be equally blocked. That is the reason for the iterative, constantly repeated attempts by the same author to try something different from the arguments employed earlier. These are questions that the author cannot answer, but as I said, cannot let go. These questions are aporetic in the technical Greek sense, where it says that, you know, the path to an answer is impossible. I want to turn now to some consideration of this question. A positivist history advanced it, and its methodological structures and rules were explored and elaborated in the 19th century. And it became clear that cognition or exploration of the past was an internally heterogeneous activity. Many different methodologically distinct cognitive projects were subsumed under the general appellation of history in the 19th century. Positive historical science in the 19th century sought to reduce the clutter of these diverse approaches to the past and reserve the title history only to the modern enterprise of knowing the past with clarity and accuracy, with the help of specific types of evidentially rigor. Alongside the demand for accuracy and chronological precision, additional methodological requirements were also announced. Use of any method implied a separation between the subjectivity of the inquirer and the abstract truth of the cognitive process. Following a specified method ensured that different knowing subjects placed in different histories could fit into the cognitive subject positions and carriers of the enterprise, uncontaminated by the conditions of individuality and space-time variations. Nietzsche's philosophical speculations disturbed the symmetries of this early methodological orthodoxy. And not surprisingly, much of the recent questioning of history and its methods has been carried under Nietzsche's banner. To carry the argument forward, I want to use an argument related to Nietzsche. To me, Foucault's reflections on genealogy, which are more well-known, appear to be a complex mixture of insight and obscurity. Certainly, there are some aspects of history in the widest sense to refer to any cognitive project regarding the past, which are captured forcefully in Foucault's essay on Nietzsche and his use of the term genealogy, which Foucault suggests is a separate methodology, a different method altogether of doing history differently. It is now generally acknowledged that recognition of the past is a far messier business than positivist history originally supposed. There is no teleology. There is no escape from ruptures that cannot be overcome. There are essentially flaws there in the historical picture that cannot, in principle, be repaired. Despite a forceful rhetoric in Foucault, it's not clear if genealogy is a different way of doing history or it's different from history itself. So I want to turn to another suggestion that comes out of the engagement with Nietzsche, but surprisingly from the analytic philosophical tradition. In his well-known work, Truth and Truthfulness, Bernard Williams makes a bold suggestion about the meaning of genealogy. Williams's discussion on the concept is linked to a reading of Nietzsche that I do not find entirely persuasive. What he says is the meaning of genealogy in Nietzsche is not, I don't think I'm convinced by that. He evidently thought that this is what Nietzsche meant by the use of the term. By genealogy, Williams thought, Nietzsche meant a question that bears a logically historical form, which is highly significant for some people for understanding something crucial about themselves, but which could not be answered by accepted techniques of historical inquiry. This description should be seen to be fairly similar to what I have described as Ambedkar's puzzle about the past. Interestingly, Williams does not treat this mode of thinking as a failed historical project, as history that has gone wrong or wayward, an inquiry that began as an historical undertaking but lost its way and ended up somewhere else at an unexpected and altered, inappropriate cognitive destination. To Williams, it's a separate kind of cognitive enterprise altogether. He treats this as a form of thinking used by thinkers who have an insistent past-related question for resolving, for which cognitive resources of conventional positivist history are not sufficient. That he takes this kind of thinking seriously is attested by the illustration he offers for this mode of reasoning. As an example of such genealogical thinking, Williams offers one of the most influential figures of thought in the whole tradition of Western political theory, the joint ideas of state of nature and social contract. At the time of the rise of the modern state, Western political theorists faced two related questions. The first was a generalized historical puzzle: how did we get here to this particular condition? The second was a related but narrower question: how did the state come to be? How did it emerge in history? To none of these questions did Western political theory at the time, as a philosophical discipline, offer a credible historical answer. I always thought, when I was a student in school and later in my undergraduation, when I read a social contract theory, that how could it be a theory of the origin of the state? In fact, that's how it was presented to me. The great answer provided to this question, which was both historically significant and intellectually fascinating, was through a fable of a social contract. The question was, how did something like the modern state, so vital to social functioning and political experience of human beings, come into existence? An historical answer in the positivist sense would have patiently tracked the prior stages in time, through the feudal state towards Roman and Greek antiquity, and if possible, pushing even further beyond. In fact, the answer supplied by contract theory followed an entirely different methodological procedure. Clearly, it was not an historical answer. However, this answer remained plausible because of the ambiguity of the original question itself. How did this come to be? How is this possible? A question that Ambedkar asks again and again about untouchability. Because ambiguous, this question could be first interpreted in two ways and then answered. The first reading of the question is, of course, historical. What are the concrete events and stages through which this state of affairs came to exist? But a second interpretation of the question, how is this possible, admits of a different kind of construction. The group that asks this question must find a way of giving it an answer that makes sense, produces an interpretation, imaginatively, of its present condition. The fable of a state of nature from which humanity emerged through a contract was a parahistory which showed, within quotes, how this state emerged, with the additional advantage that it showed this development in a way that made a constitutional agreement with the state and royal power possible and necessary. This was a substitute for history, or parahistory, that a liberal constitutionalist line of thinking gave itself to justify its future condition as a liberal state. I think Ambedkar's reflections on the origin and the history of untouchability are in principle similar. It's easy to say that at every stage, Ambedkar asks a question that is historical: how did untouchability as a social institution come into existence? But it becomes clear as well that the historical path to answering this question is blocked. Ambedkar himself constantly laments the lack of record and archive that would make it possible to give it a truly reliable answer, the only kind of answer that history admits. But from acknowledging this impasse, we, as readers of social theory, can follow two interpretative options, just like the European political theorists. The first is to view some of Ambedkar's surmises as failed history, as some people have done, as historical hypotheses lack the evidence to bear them out. The second, which is also common in India, which is often suggested in a postmodern embrace of uncertainty, is to suggest that history is given by different groups to themselves, that all history is similar, irrespective of evidential support, and that this is their history, because this is the history that Dalits gave to themselves. I want to avoid the second line, first, because it undermines one of the basic defining features of the historical enterprise, in spite of all its admitted imperfections and limitations. Secondly, it is also subtly patronizing. It's a condescending idea that although this would not qualify as a history for other groups, this will do for lower castes and untouchables. Treating these as genealogy, in the sense I mentioned above, helps avoid both these options. Possibly because Ambedkar was a student of political theory above all, this kind of reasoning might have been familiar to him. When the path to direct evidential history was obstructed, he took recourse to this alternative route. I wish to end by raising another theme in the study of Dalit thought, returning to the theme of historical melancholia. I have tried to show how, as the leading interpreter of Dalit experience of his time, Ambedkar wanted to transcend the futuristic limitation of liberal and Marxist thinking. Despite temporal positioning or orientation that instructed him to look at the present closely and keep his face turned firmly towards the future, he turned often disconsolately with an ineffable sadness towards the past. That is what these genealogical fragments in his writing, inserted in the middle of structural sociology or constitutional theorizing, are doing. He cannot help but turn back and face the past, although it is clear he knows that it is not the task at hand. One could argue that this is a strange out-of-step move from someone like Ambedkar. An obsessive fascination with the past is more understandable when it is linked to nostalgia. When the writer believes, like Gandhi, that there is something unsurpassably valuable in the past that was lost or is threatened with a loss forever. But Ambedkar's relation to the past is, in the precise sense, anti-nostalgic. He is attracted to the past, not because it contains some fading paradise. On the contrary, he is drawn to the past because it shrouds an unchronicled historical atrocity. It hides a dark stain of suffering. This feeling of shock and wonder gives rise to what Indian aesthetic theory would call chamatkara. This is the term I'm taking from a 10th century Kashmiri philosophical aesthetics. A perception that produces the dark and perverse wonder around the entirely different legitimate question, how was this possible? Chamatkara can be propelled also by the rasa of bibhatsa in ancient Indian theory. In a sense, this could be an appropriate and profound illustration of how the sentiment of jugupsa, that is, of the repugnant, abhorrent, and hateful, can create a deep and abiding wonderment in the human mind. But again, I think we should subject this gesture, despite its fragmentariness, to a serious theoretical analysis. That would reveal a line of reasoning that is hardly sentimental or vague or ambiguous. Rather, it carries an intense emotion that pursues a precisely and clearly defined cognitive object. Justice is the central value of all in Ambedkar's thought. And justice in the widest sense involves a global accounting of human experience. It is a search for justice that drives the powerful argumentation for inclusive nationalism, for constitutional representation, the purposive deployment of the power of the state apparatus to end untouchability and discrimination in the present. But this global accounting of suffering, frustratingly, can apply only to the present and the future. Modern theory advises us not to feel sentimental about the past because there is simply nothing that can be done to redeem those lives. But in Ambedkar's view, there is something deeply defeating and monstrous about this resolution. History represents, in its ideal form, a global narrative of human experience. This will mean that there would remain forever a huge hole in the middle of the historical record. The suffering of human beings in the present might be eradicated, which would mean that probably that suffering would not exist in the future. But there would remain a past in which the human suffering of untouchability was not merely not eradicated, but in a deeper travesty, not even remembered. The people of the present, Ambedkar fears, would wipe away the collective guilt of this society by a colossal act of forgetting. Ambedkar treats this as a kind of false accounting. If that happens, history would betray its promise. That is why, despite all the difficulties in the path of history, this record of suffering ought to be memorialized, he thinks, so that the people whom he called in his late writings, the broken men, are not treated to the ultimate insult of being forgotten. Political democracy bears a responsibility and a connection to history. The present must make a new accounting of the past from which silences and forgetting can be removed. At least this forgetting, at least, is remembered. His writing in these passages are not failed history or history in a lower register, but a discourse that is not history, but the lost genealogy of untouchability. It is history's permanent neighbor and scourge, which follows history like a shadow and reminds it constantly of the moral responsibilities lying at the heart of history's cognitive failures. Sometimes Ambedkar's writings remind me of Walter Benjamin's, another person whose work I like very much. One connection is easy to grasp. Both Benjamin and Ambedkar, writing around the same time, but in two corners of the world, were fascinated by the constitutive presence of structural violence in their social order. A violence so pervasive and unanswerable that it did not have to be manifested in violent acts. I want to draw your attention to a different aspect, which was not very pronounced in Ambedkar's writing. Again, I think because of its theoretical modernism. Benjamin and Ambedkar wrote about the experience of two human groups with the longest and in some ways the deepest history of exclusion known to humanity. Yet, Benjamin had a resource that Ambedkar, I think, did not. Once I taught a course at Columbia on Benjamin with a very distinguished colleague, Professor Dan Miron, a great scholar of German and Jewish literature. Teaching a class on the thesis on the philosophy of history, I wondered at the strange linguistic coloring at play in the famous passage that describes the angel of history. I'll read that passage to you. A clay painting named Angelus Novus shows, I'm quoting Benjamin, looking as though he is about to move away from something, he is fixedly contemplating. His eyes are staring, his mouth is open, his wings are spread. This is how one pictures the angel of history. His face is turned towards the past, where we perceive a certain chain of events. He sees one single catastrophe, which keeps piling wreckage upon wreckage and hurls it in front of his feet. The angel would like to stay, awaken the dead. Think of Ambedkar. The angel would like to stay, awaken the dead, and make whole what has been smashed. But a storm is blowing from paradise. It has got caught in his wings with such violence that the angel can no longer close them. This storm irresistibly propels him into the future to which his back is turned. While the pile of debris before him grows skyward, this storm is what we call progress. End of quote. Benjamin discovered in the small and spare interior of that sketch, Benjamin's semantic imagination was playing around a rather small and typically enigmatic Paul Klee sketch, which he owned. Benjamin discovered in the small and spare interior of that sketch an amazing teeming fullness. The angel had its wings spread. It could not close its wings because the storm was blowing from paradise. It was looking in dismay at the debris of civilization collecting at his feet. I had for long loved that passage, offering it a kind of uncomprehending admiration. Uncomprehending because I did not understand where the chamatkara of that passage, because this is a great example of what chamatkara means, was coming from. No ordinary Marxist could write that passage, which evoked a storm from paradise, an angel with wings, eyes gaping in wonder, and the destruction of the world. This is certainly not something Benjamin got from the mandatory optimism of the Marxist tradition. Professor Miron solved the puzzle easily in our class. It was a language Benjamin received through the Jewish prophetic tradition. For thousands of years, European Jews faced a long, unceasing historical disaster. As a people of learning and subtle intelligence, they had stalked and refined their experience of suffering in the vocabulary of a prophetic language for which the world was always at the edge of an apocalyptic end. More than other Marxists, Benjamin became the witness to the end of the Western civilization in the 1930s and 40s, precisely because of this precious, unusual heritage, the legacy of a pre-modern, deeply religious language, which was familiar with the secrets of human suffering and saw suffering as the great thread running through history. Modern languages, with their compulsory optimism and futuristic orientation, lacked the capacity to express this melancholy. Only a religious and aesthetic language could. Despised and marginalized, forced to exist outside the village as outcasts, still the Jews had a treasure that was united to the Indian untouchable in many ways, except in songs and poetry. Jews may not have had an exact chronicle of the history of their persecution, but they had a literature, above all a language, which captured the essence of their experience of history. Denial of education was like a withdrawal of all but the most rudimentary speech. The Dalits lost history from two sides. They had no place in the histories that were ever written because they were not central to them, but they did not have the resources to write a history of their own, in which they would have undoubtedly been at the center. There is no oblivion greater than being written out of history, so that after 1,000 years, there is no record that you had ever existed. This was at the heart of Ambedkar's struggles with history. Dalit Panthers, a few years after his death, opened up a new horizon of expression of the Dalit experience by harnessing precisely the power of the poetic language. I think these concerns played a role in Ambedkar's embrace of Buddhism at the end of his life, an unexpected turn from the limited prosaic languages of modern politics into a language that was vaster, more many-sided, and more colorful, and a language that declared dukkha to be at the heart of the human world. I want to thank you again for giving me the honor of being the first to lecture, honoring and remembering Kavita's creative life. Kavita was a historian of the Islamic culture of South India, a culture that she saw as her own, and a culture that she wanted to honor and celebrate, and did not want to fall off into diminution and silence. We cannot stop things from going into oblivion of time, but we're armed with the great gift of memory to rescue and revivify all that we enjoyed and loved in the lives of those who gave us the gift of respect, affection, and friendship. Thank you.
Should I sit down? Thank you, Professor Kaviraj, for that fascinating lecture. Still percolating through my head, as I'm sure is true of others in the audience. Take a few questions.
Sure.
Okay.
Although I must warn you that, you know, I've started doing this work, so I haven't actually thought through all of them. But when I thought of what I could write in Kavita's memory, because I must say that, you know, I was puzzled initially, and I thought that I was not the right person to start because I'm not a historian. When I was told that I should do it, I kept thinking, you know, what would be a good subject to deal with. And I decided that, you know, because it's a hard occasion in some way, it's appropriate to deal with something which is also intellectually hard for me, something for which I do not have always, you know, a kind of pat answer.
Yes, thank you for your insights. It was very interesting. About a decade ago, I read Ambedkar, just for my own personal edification. And what I was wondering was, how aware would an average educated Indian be actually of Ambedkar's work? And then also, to what extent does or should his work influence the current social or political movements in India, the contemporary? Because he's been gone for 60 years now, so it's quite some time. It's quite historical. So I was wondering how his work affects current Indian politics or social movements.
You know, the second question is easier to answer. I think, you know, the significance of important historical figures is an interesting question, interesting problem, because I think they become relevant intermittently. In one sense, I think Ambedkar had initially a great impact on the creation of modern India, because the I think partly accidentally, partly by intention, he got a great opportunity to shape the constitutional structure of Indian democracy. I'm saying partly by intention because, as you know, Ambedkar always had a lifelong sort of deep tension in his relation with Gandhi. But in spite of that, the end of colonial rule led to a situation which is very strange, because the man who was absolutely central to the gaining of freedom, Gandhi, I think he simply stepped aside from the scene, because he basically said that my political life is finished. I have nothing to give to the construction of the modern state. My task was essentially gaining freedom for the country, and it's done. Which creates an opportunity precisely for people like Nehru and Ambedkar, you know, to step into that void and to shape the constitution of modern India in a way which is far more modernist and radical. So I think Ambedkar had an enormous impact in that. As also happens sometimes that, you know, Ambedkar, I think, sometimes incorrectly interpreted his own influence on history, because he became frustrated, I think, too easily and resigned from Nehru's government because he thought nothing was done, nothing was being done, which is not right. I think he expected things to happen within 5 years, but in the nature of things, those were things which could happen over 50 years, right? And so I think in some ways he grossly underestimated the kind of impact that he had had on modern Indian history. But I think, you know, interventions like that, not just of Ambedkar, but of Gandhi, Nehru, Tagore, etc., they come back in different situations of crisis. And I think now, if people who think about Indian politics, Indian history, go back to Ambedkar and look at it again, I think we can draw very interesting lessons from that, because the thing which troubles me a little bit is, which can be shown in the history of many other countries. Let me give you an example from the history of this country and then go back to India. You know, when you have a great successful transformation, I think it's very easy to feel contented, you know, too easily contented, to feel that everything that needed to be done was done, which is never the case in history. And so here again, I think in American history, people need to go back and look at the history of slavery, the position of African Americans in American society and things like that. I think Indians need to do that also, because my own feeling is that we are too contented with reservation, which is given by our constitution. I don't want to go into the details of that. I think the problem with that thing is that it actually, you know, creates some perforations in the ceiling under which the untouchables and lower caste people lived, so that some of them can actually go over the ceiling. But I think the basic question was to actually lift the floor for the entire population of that community, which I don't think Indian society has been able to do. So I think learning from Ambedkar now doesn't mean simply, you know, harping on reservation and saying that we want to defend reservation, etc. Because that in a certain sense seems to me to have been exhausted. Exhausted not in the sense of being failed, but success itself actually brings an exhaustion after some time. Right? So I think that's why thinking about Ambedkar is important. And the other question, which I suspect was your first question, you know, my discussion about history, that seems to me to be a much more difficult problem in India. Because I think the way we study history, even today, is very inadequate and misleading. I sometimes, when I look back at the history that I was taught at in my school and college and university, I think I knew shamefully little about my own culture. For instance, my interest in philosophical aesthetics is something that I have pursued over the last 20 years, not through my education, right? And similarly, I think, although our education has changed in some respects, I think it needs to change much more. And the question of history, in which, you know, Kavita was involved, and I value people like Kavita precisely because of that. You know, they focused on a side of history which is in danger of being neglected and diminished. And I think that is the field in which a lot needs to be done.
I got a question. You said Ambedkar withdrew from the Jatpat Todak Mandal. Is that true?
Ambedkar?
The Lahore conference, the Jatpat Todak Mandal, right? Ambedkar did not withdraw. He sent the document to them. They read it, and that was shaking their kind of they did not, they couldn't even think about that, what he could write. So they don't want to publicize that. So they canceled the conference, right? He did not withdraw.
No, I didn't mean that. In fact, when I read it, I went over it hurriedly. But what I said was that, he wrote this.
You used the word withdrew. He did not withdraw.
Okay.
That's number one. Second thing, when you speak about lower caste, I come from I would like you to use the word native. I'm supposed to be so-called untouchable. I live in a village. I know the village structure, how it is. So it is structured. It's a different world. It's a productive world where we have farming and artisans and other things. We live in our own, world. But when you use the word Hinduism, you also, it's a modern. So you seems to think like when you use the word modern, using the word modern for Hinduism, it looks like you are relating Hinduism with kind of a modernism or is less modern. Whereas when you say kind of a lower caste or untouchable, it seems that, you used kind of a Manusrumati kind of word where they allowed us not to use the, even the good names, for example. That's in Manusrumati, it is even written that as native people, we can't even have a better names, like a modern names. So why do you do that? And also the third question, can you know your caste if you are Hindu?
Sorry?
Can you know your caste?
Can you?
Can you know your caste? Because the thing is, the people like the so-called upper caste or dominant caste, when they speak about Ambedkar, they not lived that our life, So they have the different world, So the kind of analysis world, that's why I want to ask you. If you're a Hindu, what is your caste? That will give me an idea where you are coming from. Or your level of understanding of the real life, what we live. Thank you.
No,
this is a big subject, so it can go on and on. So, yeah, thank you.
No, I think, I have responses to those. Of course, he did not withdraw it. In fact, these people didn't want him to give the whole lecture. Okay. All right. Okay, I'm sorry. The other question I think is important, the question that you asked me about caste. Caste is a structure. So one way of dealing with caste could be to say that, if I do not practice caste, in a certain sense, I have nothing to do with it. But that I don't think is the correct answer. Because whether caste exists or not, whether it has effects on other people's lives or not, does not depend on how I act as an individual. That is the nature of something which is structural. And I think Ambedkar understands that when he says that it's a structural fact, right? And when you say it's a structural fact, it immediately means that it is something which is beyond the range of effectivity that you can control by individual action. So I recognize that because I come from an upper caste, I am actually a beneficiary of that. And a lot of people who are not beneficiaries of that, they have to struggle with disabilities in society, which I have not experienced. And the more important thing from the point of view of history is that, the connection between experience and history, I think, is a difficult question, because in a certain sense, too much of immersion in the experience in writing history can lead to problems, but at the same time, experience is something which is absolutely essential in extending history in certain areas, where if you do not have that experience, there is no substitute for it. So I recognize that.
We all know Ambedkar is the father of Indian Constitution. He is actually as equal as Mahatma Gandhi, in another verse. When they're writing the Constitution, there are a lot of compromises he has to go through. Can you know anything what compromises he has to go through with Gandhi in writing the Constitution?
Did you have to compromise with Gandhi in
because regarding the, including the various caste system that are included in the Constitution, how to eliminate the caste system. And as far as I know, when I was in school, when I studied, when I learned from others, he wanted to eliminate the caste system entirely into the Constitution. But I heard, but I'm not sure, Gandhi was not ready for that at that time. Did you make any kind of research on that and have any idea about it? How that caste system was included in the Indian Constitution?
You know, it's difficult to say whether there's any direct intervention by Gandhi. I don't think, as far as I have read the Constituent Assembly debates, there's no direct intervention by Gandhi. There's a group of people inside the Constituent Assembly who are Gandhians. And they also published, there was a constitution, there was a document which was published at the time when the Constituent Assembly was working. It was called the Gandhian Constitution for India. It was published by somebody called J.C. Kumarappa, who was a Gandhian scholar, but who was also very able. He actually presented the Gandhian ideas. You know, Gandhian ideas are sometimes vague and general. To put it in a constitutional legal form is hard. But J.C. Kumarappa actually did that quite well. So that was occasionally discussed and mentioned in the Constituent Assembly debates. But I don't think there is any direct, you know, reference to Gandhi in that kind of sense, that Gandhi wants the caste system to be preserved. And, you know, I think there were some people in the Constituent Assembly who obviously wanted to minimize the modernist changes that the Constitution discussed, right? And to some extent, they were successful. But the Constitution-making process was complicated. I'll give you another example of something which is a Gandhian principle, which was not accepted by the Constitution. There were some people who suggested that because cow protection is so important to Gandhi, why don't you put it in the Constitution? Ultimately, what happens is that, you know, it's pushed into the directive principles of state policy. And some other ideas, which are Gandhian ideas, are also pushed into the directive principle. So I don't think the Constitution is a kind of victory for Gandhian ideas over modernist ideas. Or otherwise, you know, the modernist ideas could be taken probably much further forward if there was no pushback and opposition from inside the Congress itself.
So you said that language captures the essence of history. So that makes Dalit outside the history because they didn't have access to the language. But doesn't it make them outside only the official sort of narrative of history? Because as subaltern subjects, they would have access to oral history or their oral tradition. So my access to Ambedkar has been through Latin American studies because I work with indigenous communities in Latin America, so that has been my sort of homecoming to Ambedkar. So looking at Dalits through that as the subaltern subject outside the official history, but then definitely having a nexus, so definitely having their own alternative sort of narrative of history, or not that they are outside the history. They have been sort of silent subjects, but that's what precisely make them the subalterns. So that's...
You know, I think I was a member of the Subaltern Studies group, as Karuna mentioned initially, and I still I'm actually this semester teaching a course of Subaltern Studies in Colombia. And so it has given me an opportunity over the last 2-3 years when I've taught that course to go back to the experience of, you know, doing Subaltern Studies. And in the course, I start by telling the students that, you know, you should read subaltern studies carefully, but I think we need to look at one of the big holes in subaltern studies, which is difficult to explain now, that the subalternity, which is so central to Indian experience, the subaltern of caste, I think it has no place in subaltern studies except as a kind of afterthought. It was only very late, I think volume 10, that there's an essay on caste. It is taken from the work of Professor Ilaya, which is, it's an essay of a different kind. I think it's highly rhetorical. But overall, if you look at the two types of subalternities with which subaltern studies was very concerned, it was essentially the peasantry and the working class. But even about the peasantry, you can now ask that, you know, when you enter into the peasant world, how can you enter into the peasant world without thinking about caste? You can have a, not a justification, but you can have an excuse that when you are thinking about, let's say, the early factories in Bombay or early factories in Calcutta, right? The factories are places, you know, where caste is still very powerful, as Deepak Chakravarti's work or a lot of other people's work show. It's not that caste disappears. How can it disappear? You know, it actually structures all human relationships in the country. But even then, you know, their salience is relatively less. But when you move into the world of the peasantry, how can you not take caste, you know, much more seriously? My suspicion is that, you know, the person who was our guru in a certain sense, Ranajit Guha, I think in his case, you should notice carefully the kind of peasant rebellion that Ranajit Guha initially focused on, like the Santal rebellion, which is the tribal rebellion. You know, the rebellions which are done by David Hardiman, who again wrote in subaltern studies, those are essentially tribal rebellions, right? So that might have been one reason why, when they went back into the official records, the question of caste actually did not leap out of it, you know, like that. But even then, I don't think there's any excuse for not getting to the question of caste, because you cannot write about subalternity in India absenting caste. I think it's just impossible.
Going to look at this from a little different angle. I need some clarification on your arguments about liberalism. About liberalism, yeah. Or the tone that you found in Ambedkar's writing and the reference to that. But I'm going to make some suggestions about how I saw or perhaps possibly radically misunderstood what you said. And I want to refer to today and to this place in making that point. We're in the art museum, and you started with the reference to Caravaggio. And in Caravaggio, you saw only the darkness and the melancholy. And I think most observers of Caravaggio see the contrast and the fact that in this darkness, there was also tremendous brightness and contrast, and the figures are about resurrection and movement up. And so I'm wondering about that single focus. Today is November 9th. And the references to Benjamin make this particularly salient. This is the 80th anniversary of Kristallnacht. Kristallnacht itself is Caravaggesque in its combination of the night and the darkness and the crystal and the sparkle. And there's two sides to this. Your reading of the Chamatkari from the Kashmiri seems to ignore the Marathi sense of the term, which involves a glisten or a flash and a brightness. And I think that's true in the Hindi uses also. So there's this tendency to the way in which you've taken the most anti-liberal thinkers of recent modernity, Nietzsche and Benjamin, and looked at them in their most saturnine, dark, melancholic ways, and then somehow you're going to impute this to a good Enlightenment liberal like Ambedkar. So that's why I'm confused. So it just seems like such a strange move to get from the liberty, equality, fraternity, from avoiding the suffering, from rejecting the past, to creating a new world which doesn't have any of these bounds of the past, to this kind of Benjaminian, melancholic, you know, we can't avoid the past, it's throwing us backwards into the future. Thank you.
Thank you. I think that's a very good question. I think it partly, what you said at the end was also the kind of question that struck me when I started thinking about it. And you were also quite right in some ways that, you know, liberalism and Marxism, these are predominantly, but only predominantly, because, you know, when you think about either Hinduism or Islam or liberalism or Marxism, there are huge bodies of thought. And I feel that, you know, when we are dealing with bodies of thought of that scope and we are using this, you know, singular term like liberalism or Marxism, we should not see them as something which is united like a doctrine. I believe that they're united like what structuralists would call a language, you know, like an alphabet. So the, you know, the 16 alphabets of the English language produce all the sentences that are ever written in English. So the sentences have meaning, but the alphabet itself doesn't have any meaning. So I think liberalism and socialism are both, the more they get elaborated, I think the more they acquire the character of an alphabet rather than a language, rather than a doctrine. And there are different types of doctrinal positions which can be developed. I agree with you that the people that I selected, Benjamin, as I pointed out myself, that, you know, Benjamin is a very, very unusual, very exceptional Marxist. But I thought, and there's no doubt that, you know, Ambedkar is a great follower of the Enlightenment. And that's why I said several times that, you know, he is the great representative of the liberal language in India. But in spite of that, I think I feel very strongly that in Ambedkar, you know, there's a kind of inconsolable, you know, element, inconsolable feeling, you know, of loss whenever he turns towards history. And because he is not a historian, he cannot do anything. He's supremely intelligent, so therefore he realizes, even if he had all the skills of a historian, it's a kind of thing where history might not be able to give answers. But I think it links up with something which you get in people like Benjamin as well. So that's why I feel that, you know, there is this kind of darkness which attaches to Ambedkar. But it does not, I'm not suggesting that it actually, you know, overbalances or overwhelms the fundamentally positive, you know, lighted character of liberalism, Marxism, and the future-oriented feeling of hope. But if you think of somebody like, let's say, in the Marxist tradition, somebody I find very interesting, but also very enigmatic, you know, someone like Ernest Bloch and the principle of hope, you'll see Ernest Bloch actually also goes back to something like that. So I personally, what I'm suggesting here is not that, you know, Ambedkar had that in himself. What I'm suggesting is something which is less, you know, less certain, it's more elusive, but it is something that I want to suggest, that, you know, he needed something. People, if they have to come to terms with that kind of history, they need something, you know, which is more poetic, which is more elusive, which the language of liberalism and Marxism, I think you agree with me, does not provide us with the resources to deal with that. And my sense is this is something that I want to read about and much more think about more. I think it's actually might have something to do with the turn towards Buddhism towards the end of his life, which again, in spite of his occasional references to Buddhism and his thinking Buddhism is totally anti-caste, etc. But those are episodic. And the turn towards Buddhism at the end of his life seems to me to show something which is deeper. In my kind of reading, it might actually mean that at the end of his life, he recognizes what I'm saying, that there are certain things which you cannot do through the resources of liberalism. You need something which is not like liberalism, not like socialism. I don't know, this is speculative, as I said, and for this.
Thank you for this really rich talk. I wanted to go back to something that perhaps is related to what Lee was just asking you, but I'm not sure, because I feel like I can't quite get my mind around all the questions that I have that were elicited. But one of the things I was really interested in is the way that you were using genealogy. And I was struck because when you talked about thinking of the genealogical, you said something about the door of history is shut, and that's the most personal metaphor that Ambedkar uses in that essay that you're working from, the seminar paper. It seems really significant to me because he doesn't talk, you were talking about him speaking from the Dalit experience, but he's not personal at all. It's the impersonality that I think is part of what is the tone that you're talking about. And I can't figure out, when I read that essay, I read a lot of anger. I don't recognize as much the kind of affect you're talking about. But I couldn't figure out, just thinking about the genealogical and how the argument you're making with him talking about it in terms of a genesis, it seems that the etymological link is really important, especially for someone who's really thinking a lot about genetic and kind of his way of reading caste. So I'm wondering if you could say more about the way that you think he's engaging in this kind of ongoing historical project when he writes a seminar paper as a graduate student, that he's talking about it in terms of the genesis. There's something there that I'm very interested in having you talk about a little more.
You know, I have done some thinking about that because I'm actually doing a close reading. Close meaning, you know, I also occasionally write on literature, and literature forces you to do a kind of close reading which we do not do in political theory. Because literature forces you to ask whether, you know, this particular verb, there could be something else, and why the author did not use something else in this particular word. And so close reading means to me, that's what I also meant when I said that political theory can benefit from techniques of literary reading, because there's a kind of close reading in literature which we normally do not do to writing of political theory, because what we try to follow, we follow that very closely, but what we try to follow closely is the argument, not the presentation of the argument in the, you know, the texture of the language itself and things like that. What I'm suggesting that is we should do that. I agree with you. What I wanted to play up in that paper is, in a certain sense, the unnecessariness of the term genesis, because it's presenting the paper in a seminar, which is about primitive societies. And I think it's assumed in the discussion about primitive societies that they're not ancient in that sense. I have a small passage on the difference between the ancient and the primitive. So when you cannot do to a society, you know, apply to a society the term ancient, because it actually carries behind it a certain kind of implicit epistemology, then you rummage for something else, you grope for something else, and what you use there is primitive. So that strikes me very strongly in that essay. And also the thing is that, you know, he tries to make an opening to go towards the genesis question, but ultimately the material that he has forces him to come back and to give it a kind of mechanism question, you know, which today we would call a structural. If we have a much more fluent vocabulary for that because of the distinction between history and structure. So essentially what he's saying is that, you know, we cannot have a diachronic historical account. So the only account that we have to be content with is a kind of structural, synchronic structural account. So that strikes me very strongly. You also mentioned something which I think is a very insightful point, which is linked to this discussion about liberalism. As you said, because he's a liberal, I think there's a deep unwillingness in Ambedkar to talk about his own personal experience. He does occasionally write about his personal experience, but when he's making a more general, significant argument, he doesn't bring in his personal experience very often, because there is a kind of impersonality which is demanded by modern social science, partly demanded by the language, these languages which led to the development of the modern social science, you know, through socialism, liberalism, etc. Their shared epistemic premises, etc. It's because of that that he's resistant to that. But there's also a lot of anger. One thing that I do not, I haven't thought through yet, is that if you bring in the question of affect, you know, there are two types of affect which are very different. You know, one is the emotion of anger, and other one is the emotion of grief. They can be linked. For instance, in the Kashmiri philosophical tradition, they sometimes would talk about not merely differences but also sequences, in the sense that, you know, one emotion is a neighbor to another emotion, which is neighbor to another emotion, etc. Right? So they think of neighborliness between emotions. So there is a kind of link between the emotion of anger and the emotion of grief. And you are quite right that what I see more often in Ambedkar's writing is a kind of anger. But I feel that when he turns to history, there's also this feeling of melancholy, which to me sort of seems to speak from behind that. I agree with your point that I should not overplay the question of melancholy, because he is a liberal thinker after all, and liberalism actually has a lot of commitments of different kinds. And being a melancholic in a Benjaminian kind of sense, I think, goes against a certain very deep commitment in liberalism, right? But I think when we look at the other two essays, which I want to do in greater detail in this kind of analysis, Who Are the Shudras and the Origins of Untouchability, I think that again would open up, you know, complex relationships like that. But thank you for your question.
Please help me in thanking Professor Kaviraj for his presentation.